Well, good morning, everyone. I pray that you are having a blessed day. This was going to be on Facebook Live, but thanks to technology, I guess when Facebook went down last week, they forgot to put the live link back up for pages or something. I don't know. I'll send a message out to Zuckerberg. We're good friends, so he'll get right on it for us. All right, so couple of things that I want to open with for us is announcements. First one, resuming on October 31st, is our in-house Bible study. So it begins at 9 a.m. It's right in our back room back here. We are starting with, it looks like, the book of Joel. We're in the Minor Prophets right now. So please join us for 9 a.m. It is a fantastic, fantastic study time. Additionally, we will be doing the Christmas or the Advent Book Club. I have no good name for it yet. But we will be following Timothy Keller's Hidden Christmas. It's a pretty short book that focuses on like the real meaning behind Christmas. It is an exceptional book. I know that all of you will be blessed by reading it and joining it. We will be doing that beginning on November 21st from 1 to 2 p.m. It's Sunday afternoons. And it will be on Zoom, so please let me know if you're planning to attend so that I can get you added to our list. But it will be a fantastic time held by all, I promise. And then additionally, for those of you who are seeing this, our leadership meeting, our quarterly meeting, will be held in the library back there next Sunday, October 17th, immediately following the service. So I look forward to seeing all of you then at that. I should say specifically our leadership team. Those are the announcements and the news that I have. So we're going to do things a little different today as we're trying to make it more friendly for those who are watching online and allows us to stretch ourselves more during our worship service. So when we call ourselves to worship now going forward, we're going to open with a hymn and then we are going to do a responsive reading, or I should say responding to the word, which will be read by me. So let us open our hymnals now to our first hymn of the day, Come We That Love the Lord, number 16 in your hymnals. Thank you. You may be seated. All right. Today's opening hymn that I ask that you pray on as we recite it, that you let it center yourself into our worship today, is Psalm 9. I'll be reading verses 1 through 11. And the word of the Lord says this: I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart. I will recount all your wonderful deeds. I will be glad in exalting you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High. When my enemies turn back, they stumble and perish before your presence. For you have maintained my just cause. You have sat on the throne, giving righteous judgment. You have rebuked the nations. You have made the wicked perish. You have blotted out their name forever and ever. The enemy came to an end in everlasting ruins. Their cities you rooted out. The very memory of them perished. But the Lord sits enthroned forever. He has established his throne for justice and the judges of the world with righteousness. He judges the people with uprightness. The Lord is a stronghold for the oppressed, a stronghold in the times of trouble. And those who know your name and put their trust in you, for you, O God, have not forsaken those who seek you. Sing praises to the Lord who sits enthroned on Zion. Tell them among the people and his deeds. Amen. Let us take a moment of silent reflection and prayer to let the hymn wash over us, to let the psalm wash over us, to center ourselves into God's presence. And then we will recite the Lord's Prayer together following that pastoral prayer. Lord, thank you for being with us today. May we feel your presence as we worship you in this moment. I pray for all of our beloved brothers and sisters that they remain healthy and healthy, and that those who are in mourning, those who are in pain, and those who are struggling, Lord, I pray that you wrap security around them. I pray that they feel your presence at every moment, and I pray that they seek your face. Lord, we can pray this because of who you are. You are a great, loving God. You are perfect in your actions. You are perfect in your wisdom. You are perfect in your justice. And sometimes it doesn't feel it, Lord, but you are making all things right. You are redeeming this world. And I pray that you are with us every step of the way. And so when we struggle to pray, when we're not quite sure where you are, Lord, I pray that we were reminded to pray as our Lord and Savior Jesus has instructed us. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Please rise for the doxology. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here. Thank you. You may be seated. All right. Reading from the Word today is from Hebrews chapter 13. Hebrews chapter 13. And the Word of the Lord says this: Let your brotherly love continue. Do not neglect to show hospitality to the strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels while unaware. Remember those who are in prison as those in prison with him, and those who are mistreated, since you also are in the body. Let marriage be held in honor among all things, and let the marriage bed be undefiled, for the God will judge the immoral and the adulterous. Keep your life free from the love of money, and be content with what you have. For he has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So we can confidently say, the Lord is my helper, I will not fear. What can man do to me? Remember your leaders and those who spoke to you with the word of God. Consider the outcome of their way of life and the intermediate of their faith. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. Do not be led away by diverse and strange teachings, for it is good for the heart to be strengthened by grace, not by foods which have not benefited those devoted to them. We have an altar in which those who serve the tent have no right to eat. For the bodies of the animals, the blood that those have brought into this holy places by the high priest as a sacrifice for the sin are burned outside the camp. So Jesus also suffered outside the gate in order to sanctify the people through his own blood. Therefore, let us go to him outside the camp and bear the reproach he endured. For here we have no lasting city, but we seek the city is to come. Through him, then, let us continually offer up sacrifice of praise to God, that the fruit of our lips, and with them we acknowledge his name. Do not neglect to do good and to share what you have, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God. Obey our leaders and submit to them, for they are the keeping watch over our souls. As those who will have to give an account, let them do this with joy and not with groaning, for that would be of no advantage to you. Pray for us, for we are sure to be of clear conscience, desiring to act honorably in all things. I urge you more earnestly to do this in order that I may be restored to you sooner. Amen. In it, the author of Hebrews outlines the anchors of our faith, which we'll talk about in a few moments. Let us open our hymnals now to our second hymn, Give to the Winds Your Fears. It's number 405. Thank you. Thank you. You may be seated. All right. Excuse me for the water break, but I was getting parched. I like that word, parched. It's not used enough in common nomenclature. All right, today's passage is on Matthew chapter 6. It's verses 24. I guess that's just a verse, not verses. It's just verse 24. No one can serve two masters, for either you will hate one and love the other, or you will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. So this verse is the final thought in these three thoughts that we've been wrestling with over the last 3 weeks, in which Jesus is delivering this teaching on, essentially, I believe, as I've described it, who do you worship? Do you worship God? Or do you worship money, material things, financial things? We talked about laying up treasures in heaven, where God, where Jesus instructs us, do not lay up treasures in heaven. In fact, instead, do things to grow treasures. Or do not lay up treasures on earth, and in fact, do things that grow up treasures in heaven. Well, I was almost a heretic for a second. All right. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for backing me up on that one. When we talked about, Jesus continues to talk about how the eye is a lamp, and if your body is healthy, it'll be shining. Essentially, what you're focused on in your worship is what will guide you. And then he closes it out without mincing words. You cannot serve God and money. This is an incredibly hard passage for the average American Christian. I'm just being blunt here. We like money. We like things. We like stuff. And I'm using the we because I'm one of them. I have struggled with this my whole life. I always want the newest toy, the newest thing, the newest item. It drives my wife mad. I blame it on being an only child and that being things being the only things I had, but that has long since left. I should have figured it out by now. So I am just as guilty as anyone else in this talk. So understand that if you know the old adage and you're pointing your finger forward, you got three fingers pointing at you. I'm very aware of that scenario in here. And so I was very convicted throughout the course of this week. But it is a very American thing to want things and to want stuff. We are capitalistic by nature. That is our form of our economy. The desire to have more, to get more, to not be satisfied with what you have is an inherent truth. We almost, as Americans, feel like the Declaration of Independence said that we should be pursuing life, liberty, and the pursuit of wealthiness. Because that is our goal, that is our desire. And I'm not saying anything that I don't think you guys agree or disagree with. I doubt you guys disagree with it because it's a pretty common theme. It's a pretty common thought. The almighty dollar rules our country. It rules many of our hearts. You've heard me time and time again preach against the prosperity gospel, as I call it, the prosperity heresy. And those who preach it, who I believe firmly are false teachers, who essentially tie financial wealth and prosperity with God's favor and saying, do you want God to bless you? Then you have to be faithful to him. And if you're struggling with money and you're struggling with being in poverty, if you're struggling with not having enough to pay the bills or you can't get that brand new car that you want, then you're just not being faithful enough. Then you're not worshiping God hard enough. You see, I preach against that because that is false, biblically speaking. And I always love how those preachers, like the famous ones out there, they always reply back. I won't use their names, but you may have a few of them ringing your heads. They always say, you know what? If you're not happy, if you're not rich, then you're not faithfully following God because God wants you to send me money. And if you're not sending me money, then God's not going to give you money. Like, that's how finance works. But that's how they preach. I heard one of them, one of the most disgusting sermons that I ever heard in my life. They basically said, if you want to be blessed by God, then you need to prayerfully consider taking out a second mortgage on your house and sending me the money, because then God will bless you. And I just think to myself, Why wouldn't they just take out a second mortgage on their house and keep the money? Then God has blessed them already. But that doesn't get the Kenneth Copelands of the world and the Joe Osteens of the world and the Cooper Dollars of the world. That doesn't get them their private jets. That doesn't build them their giant million-dollar houses. So absolutely, I believe that the prosperity gospel is heresy. But at the same time, there's a reason why millions of Americans follow it. It's because it is through and through an American gospel. Because we always want more, right? Think about the benchmarks in your life in which you've focused on, when I finally get to this level, I'll be happy financially. If I were to ask you right now in your minds to say, at what dollar amount per year would you consider yourself comfortable? And I guarantee you guys would not be able to give me a dollar number, a dollar figure. You would give me a word. More. Because that's the word. It's more. We want more. We need more. And I'm not saying all of you have this in your hearts. I'm just saying that this is something that many of our brothers and sisters in churches have to wrestle with. It's something that our culture in America is tooled and designed to focus on. If you don't think that that's true, then maybe if you remind my illustration a little while ago about how a company, Dasani, spent $15 million to market an ad to the Super Bowl to celebrate how they spent $100,000 in donating water to Detroit. They spent $15 million to celebrate donating $100,000. Why is that even a thing? It's because they want you to buy more of their product. And so they're willing to spend any amount, and they think you care about helping other people, and so they will. Now, in a biblical worldview, you would spend $15,100,000 on helping people in Detroit with water, but that's not our modern worldview. And so you can see how this impacts people time and time again. If you asked, I should say, statistically speaking, the number one reason why marriages end is finance. If you were to talk to a therapist, the number one reason for anxiety in someone's life is finance. And I love therapists out there who will listen to someone at $100 an hour complain to them that they can't pay their rent. It's great. I'm not knocking therapy. I've gone to it many times and it's helped me, but there's still that element of finance behind it that impacts us. And I asked myself why this week. Why is so many Americans struggling about being able to pay, being able to keep up with the Joneses, so to speak, to be able to afford? Like, why is this such an anchor? When you look at the statistics, and it's staggering. If you make $800,000 a year, you are in the top 1% of the world's richest people. The top 1%. And that seems like a high number. I will never see $800,000 a year. I could never want to do that. But there's people in our community that do, that are. They're the top 1% richest people in the world. They don't think it. They don't react that way. But when people are boycotting the 1% at Wall Street, they're talking about them. That seems high though. But if you make $93,000 a year as a family, as a total income, you are in the top 10% richest people in the world. $93,000, that seems low, but that is true. And if you made $4,000 last year, $4,000, then you are in the top 50% of world income. America is rich beyond our imaginations. We are the most prosperous nation in the history of the world. And people struggle with anxiety at record levels. People struggle with depression at record levels. Marriages are falling apart at record levels. Kids are being born into generation after generation of angst, suffering, and stress because of this. Why? Because when you worship money, money just asks for more. And that is what so many of our beloved brothers and sisters do, is they worship money. But Jesus makes it clear, you can't serve two masters. You're going to love one and hate the other. So if you're focused on serving the almighty dollar and making sure that you get that promotion at work and that you buy that new toy and you have all of this money so that you can feel comfortable, if that's your focus and you get passed up for that promotion, then you start getting mad at God. Because God, I thought you wanted me to be happy. I thought you wanted me to be rich. And then the prosperity heresy comes in and says, well, you just didn't pray enough. You didn't bless enough. You didn't send so-and-so televangelist your second mortgage, so that's why you didn't get that promotion. You can see how it kind of builds and spirals, but it's true. But I want to give you an illustration directly from my own personal life of where I watched this work. So in 2007, I was promoted to assistant manager and moved out to Reno, Nevada, from Augusta, Maine. It's a trip of a lifetime. I loved it. I loved being out there. I loved waking up in the morning and having to set an alarm because football starts at 10 a.m. You got to get your fantasy football team ready. And that the Monday night game that I'm usually having to debate whether or not I want to be extremely exhausted the following morning or watch it just didn't happen because you were watching the game over dinner. And it was over by 8 o'clock. It was fantastic. I loved every second of it out there. But I got promoted and moved out there. And my wife and I did very well for each other. She was able to be a stay-at-home mom. At the time, Kira was less than a year old. Zachary was not born yet. But while we lived out there, Zachary was born. So we had a small family. We went from apartment to apartment. We were living nicely. And I got promoted again. And we were able to live really well. And we were able to make everything work for us. We were able to buy a house in 2009, which was far better than anything I could ever imagine buying. If you remember, 2008 was that housing crisis. So in 2006 and 2005, a bunch of houses were built out there that were really nice, like $600,000-$700,000 houses. Well, in 2010, they were still really nice houses, but nobody could afford them anymore. Their market crashes, but they were dirt cheap. So we were able to buy a house for, frankly, less than probably one we could buy around here right now. And it was a really nice house, and we loved it, and we filled it with a lot of really great things, and it was awesome. Until I lost my job. I was downsized. And then we had a mortgage payment, which was still not bad, but not something we could afford. We had a lot of debt incurred over house maintenance and building it up and doing everything, and we couldn't handle it, so we had to sell the house and move back here. And in the process of about 6 weeks, we went from having our dream home, which I still miss from time to time, but not as much as I think I thought I would. We went from having our dream home to being so blessed by my sister-in-law that we were able to stay in her one spare bedroom. All four of us at the time with a very pregnant Amber. We were staying in a one bedroom for about 6 weeks before I could find a part-time job that paid a little over minimum wage. And I found it, praise God, I was able to get work at Pine State and as customer service on the phones. And it was enough for us to be able to buy a little tiny two-bedroom apartment that was nothing fancy at all. But it was a blessing in Oakland. And I had some of the best times of my life there. Kira was less than one, Kira was over one now. Zachary was still a little one. Gabe was just born in that little house. And I remember hosting many a hockey game. We watched the Bruins win the Stanley Cup in that house, which was amazing. Some of the best times we ever had there. And we were the poorest I've ever been. Absolutely ever been. In fact, we had this running gag, which I loved. God always provided me a TV because I think he knew how important PBS was when you have three little kids. But I had a TV that would break. And this happened four or five times in a row that me and my friend John stopped feeling like it was a coincidence. Because I had a TV that broke. And then the next day, driving along the side of the road, I saw one projection TV out on the side of the road free. And so we took it. It worked great. And that lasted us for about a year. And then that broke. And then a day later, my mother-in-law calls me and says, hey, there's a TV out on the side of the road right across the street from us. Pick that up. And that lasted us for about a year, which was great. And then that broke. And then John called me and he was with us for the whole journey saying, you guys are blessed with TVs. Finally, he calls me. He's like, you'll never believe what's right across from my mom's house right now. She just wheeled it into her garage for you. Just come get it. And it was just over and over and happened 4 or 5 times. It was just amazing. Just whenever we needed a TV, it was produced for us at the moment. Not before, not after, but right there. That's I'm not saying that like God was blessing me, so send me all money so that I can keep getting TVs. No, what I'm saying is just God knew that we really needed to have Dinosaur Train and Sesame Street on at the house, and he wasn't going to make the kids suffer for that. But it was moments like that that I remember on that I enjoy. And so since we've been able to dig ourselves out and get a more comfortable scenario with my wife now having her job and me here as well as other ventures, I can't help but reflect back and say that the best scenario we were in when we were in Reno, I don't think we were our happiest. At least for me, it was when I was really, really struggling in those apartments. Because that was the time that I was still wrestling. My wife and I, we were saved when we were out in Reno. And so I didn't really focus on God that much. More and more, obviously, but not like what I did when I was back here and I started school and I started wrestling and God became the central focus. And suddenly, our financial situation wasn't as important. We were blessed enough to have safety net after safety net from our government to keep us going and to keep us earning, and it got us through school and it got me through school, and it was blessing after blessing. But money stopped being the primary thing that we had focused on, and that was a delightful time when we were there. And it wasn't only until we really lost it all that I could safely say, yes, this was the moment. And so it's so important for us to understand that. We will chase money until our grave if we desire, and then it'll be passed on to our family and our kids. I heard someone once say that a life focused on chasing money will only produce spoiled children. And that's true to an extent. And this isn't something that's easy for us. I mean, we have to go back and justify why we get everything. We need a new furnace. We need a new heater. We need this, we need that. We have a very stressful job, so a jet ski will help us on the weekends. We do little things like that to justify, but we have to make sure that we have, at the very least, a balance, if not completely God-centered focused. Because if we seek money at its heart, that is self-service. That's serving ourselves. We're producing income for ourselves. We're getting ourselves more and bigger. We're serving ourselves. God doesn't call us to serve ourselves. He calls us to serve others. And so when we worship God, we find ourselves having to help other people rather than helping ourselves. So if we have an extra $20 or $30, it stops being about what can I spend this on and starts being who can I give this to? And it's that mindset and that heart, that change that makes such a dramatic impact in our lives. And the point of why Jesus is putting this entire passage here is because he wants us to understand that our hearts are what need to be faithful to God, not our words, not our actions. He talked about how fasting without the right heart is wrong, prayer without the right heart is wrong. It's about, why do we seek to get more? Why do we seek to earn more? Why do we get frustrated if our raise is only 2% instead of 10%? Why does this stuff make us anxious and upset all the time? Part of it is because we feel undervalued if it's not, which could be fair in a conversation, but it shouldn't never be about the actual physical dollar, because the dollar should be dedicated to God. And we see this time and time again. My final illustration for this point is if you talk to the average Christian and you talk about giving an offering to a church, they may be quick to say, God doesn't tell us that we have to tithe. Tithing is giving 10% of your first fruits. It was part of God's expectation covenant with Israel that they would produce, and the first 10% that they would give right off the top would go to God. And they say, we don't have to do that anymore. God doesn't tell us to tithe anymore. That's part of the Old Testament, the Old Covenant. It's like, well, yeah, sure. I mean, you can make a theological argument for that. Except it doesn't help your case, because Jesus was in quite the opposite camp. Jesus said, give everything. Jesus, when talking with a rich fool who came up to him and said, how can I obtain heaven? Jesus says, you keep the law. Do not steal. Do not anger. Honor your parents. Don't create idols. And the guy's like, yeah, I've done all that. And Jesus says, one other thing. Sell everything, give it to the poor, and follow me. And the rich man left because he had a lot of money. You're right. Jesus doesn't tell us to tithe. He tells us to do so much more. You have the illustration at the temple where a poor widow takes two small copper coins and puts them into the offering that all of these other wealthy people are throwing in gobs of money. And Jesus pulls the disciples aside and says, that widow put in more than all of the other people because she gave everything she had. She gave out of her poverty. She didn't give out of her wealth. The other people were tithing. She was giving everything to the Lord. And I'm not saying that to fill up our coffers. That's not the point of this message at all. The point is, who do we worship when we use our finances, when we use our money? Do we worship ourselves by trying to follow this materialistic worldview that the world desperately wants us to have? Or do we use it to follow God by giving to charity and helping other people and blessing everyone we can possibly imagine? Those are the two things God wants us to wrestle with. Because this passage, at its heart, isn't about money. It's about who do you worship? Are you worshiping the world and what the world wants you to have value? Or are you worshiping God? Worshiping God doesn't only mean your money, it especially means your time in prayer, in biblical study, in helping and volunteering with other people, in reaching out to those who are sick or ill or following up, to inviting other people to church. That is the worship of God, to work on his kingdom, to be a member of it, and to work for the betterment of his kingdom. So yeah, as we end this passage, I'll let you take that little question home with you. Who do you serve? Let us pray. Lord, thank you. Thank you for blessing us. I believe that we could not have been born in a greater country. We have opportunity and prosperity that most of the world doesn't have. So thank you, Lord. But I pray that that doesn't make us complacent. I pray that that doesn't let us feel like everyone else is as blessed as us. Lord, let us be reminded that we have missionaries living in poverty, real poverty, Lord. Poverty that would make the homeless crisis in America look like a yacht club. And that they are actively working to better lives there. Lord, I pray that we are reminded that just because we have our oil tanks filled in our community doesn't mean everyone does. And that we seek out those who need help. And Lord, just because we are confident that our Christmas trees are going to be full doesn't mean every kid will be opening a gift on Sunday. Or Christmas, I should say. But Lord, I pray that we are encouraged to help them. Look after us, Lord. Convict us in our hearts, you Holy Spirit, and change us so that we may be faithfully following you at all times, Lord. Be with us, for we ask this in your name. Amen. All right, let us open our hymnals now to number 312, Simply Trusting Every Day. Lord, thank you for being such a great and wonderful and merciful God. Allow us to walk out from here trusting you, trusting in your Son and following him. Lord, open our eyes to the needs around us. Allow us to be convicted and to find ways to help them. Let our hearts be opened and be welcome to new experiences. Let us have moments in which we see you working. And Lord, be with us in our struggles and our sorrow. Walk with us, Lord, for we ask this in your name. Amen. Thank you all. I pray you have a blessed rest of your Sunday and a blessed week.
You too.
Goodbye, everyone.